Okay, so time is of the essence here, very limited on time. This really is a three-hour lecture, okay? So I'm sure you don't want to stay with me till 1 o'clock in the morning, so I'm going to move pretty fast through it. So I wouldn't sit there trying to write everything down. If there's anything you don't understand, make a note of the slide. I'm here. I'm here the whole weekend. I'm doing a workshop on Monday, and I'm more than happy to chat to you about it. It's important because we only get once a year at this, and there's so much stuff I've got to tell you. I need your help on this. I really need some help to get through this. I'm going to pause on some. Others, I'm just going to pull a sentence off. Okay, there'll be a lot more on the slides, but I just need to pull a sentence off of some of them. There's a couple of things I don't really talk about. One is cancer. That's not my bag. Autism isn't really my bag either. I don't really talk about that. I do get pulled on that sometimes. They're important subjects. Other people deal with them. I'm talking about the stuff that affects everyone in this room and everyone you know, okay? And I will be talking about how the brain develops as well, and we'll be going into that. There's much more I'd like to talk about, but really it would take a whole day. So are you ready?
Yes.
Yeah? Please don't ask any questions. I can't go back on a slide. Absolutely afterwards, I'll stay up all night with you and talk to you if you want, but just for the moment, I just don't have the time. So quickly, everyone knows about algorithms. There's companies that are using Facebook to put micro-targeted ads in to get you to change your political opinion. We all know that. They're using algorithms to nudge us. There's stacks of stuff in the papers about AI systems, artificial intelligence, beating gamers. This particular system committed suicide when it got confused, which is not good. In the universities, they're talking about AI, and they said, look, we really need to consider whether AI and robots are going to have feelings, and we need to start working on this from a legal framework. Other magazines are saying, just get on with it. This guy's looking for his AI dog. Just embrace it. It's going to be a wonderful thing. And of course, Brexit is a problem for everything, apparently, and it delayed the UK's government's AI digital strategy. And of course, smartphones, even when you're offline, will be gathering data about you, and they will be predicting what you're going to do. We all kind of know that stuff. I could show you 1,000 things on scary robots. I've picked an unscary robot for you there. This robot follows you around, and it does everything for you, from ordering your dinner and all the rest of it, and you can buy them. Okay, we all know that. That is a scary robot. The word robota means forced labor, yeah, or drudgery, compulsive service. Now, there are two things I want you to know. There's applied AI and artificial general intelligence. Now, applied AI is the narrow AI. You know the stuff when you ring up the bank and it says, did you say yes? And you say yes. And then you say, did you say no? And he said no. He said, did you say yes? And you go on for hours and hours and hours. That's applied AI. That's not that bad. That's not the major threat. The general intelligence one is the threat. That is something what they call the deep mind. That is where they're mimicking our brains, our minds. And that's the stuff they want to put into robots, and that is the danger, okay? Now, I'm going to come straight out the bat and give you this straight and not delay this. This is Mr. Jacobstein, and he's the chair for Artificial Intelligence and Robotics and Singularity University. Listen to this.
I do think that people are going to be surprised at how fast machine learning is going to displace routine jobs.
That's true.
And I think that we need to start planning now.
How fast are
those,
we talking?
Well, we're talking about a transition that's going to occur over the next 10 to 15 years that is really significant. I mean, the Oxford Martin School did a study of this, of routine jobs and the vulnerability to displacement by machine learning over the next 10 to 20 years, and they concluded that 47% of US jobs would be vulnerable. And then they did a deeper analysis, and it turns out to be higher in some cities than in others in the US, and they extended their analysis to the globe, and they concluded that developing countries have an even higher percentage of routine jobs, where the vulnerability to automation could be as high as 60 to 85%. Now, that is a very big deal. It could be destabilizing, and for that reason, I think that we need to invest heavily in free education for people, and also various schemas for doing a basic income. There are lots of disagreements about what the optimal plan would be, but I think the important thing is for us to be proactive and to sort of get ahead of this trend before it comes back to bite us.
Did you just hear what you just said? What did he just say? What he just said was, you're all going to go on the dole. Right. Now, I haven't got time to get any questions, but, okay. Have a look what happens to people on the dole. okay? And just, if you think that's a good thing, where you live, okay, how much money you get, you'll be told where to live, and if you look to Australia, what happens there on the dole or on Social Security if you don't want to have a vaccine? What happens to your money? If there's one thing you need to remember from this weekend or from my talk, is that's it, okay? And how many years did he say? 10 to 15 years. If you've got no job, how can you withdraw your... What power have you got? How can you withdraw your labour? The study is this study here. There's another study that backs it up, just come up and said some of these jobs have already gone, they're never coming back. This is huge. Who knows about Agenda 2030? Yeah. This is huge. If you have no work, you have absolutely no power. Okay? And that alone is a whole subject. Well, it's handy, this, because if you're not going to have jobs, well, people who don't have college degrees in the States, normally they would spend a fraction, three quarters of their time working. Now they're spending it on video games. Isn't that an interesting coincidence that this is just trending in just at the same time, that these people who aren't going to get jobs, well, they'll be entertained on their video games. What this is called is called the Fourth Industrial Revolution. And as I said, don't try and read it all, but what they're saying is, well, what we've got to do is we've got to give free education. We've got to keep those humans educated to keep up with this artificial intelligence. It's never going to happen. It's going to outstrip us so fast, your feet aren't going to touch the ground. But it's okay, because at the bottom it says, look, but the primacy of human dignity is what we need to keep. I'm a little bit confused, because they're calling it post-human. So how do you keep human dignity when you've gone past humans? And these conferences are going all over. At the end of this talk, you're going to have no doubt that this is everywhere, and the ship has changed direction, and this is the way it's going, and no one has asked your permission. And there's all these kind of studies, these kind of conferences going on. They want queer studies, religious studies, all these people to speak on. Now, even Netflix, this isn't a joke. He was asked about this. He said, we don't even know who we're going to be entertaining. So we're looking at our business models. We might actually be entertaining AI and robots. Now, really, it's two things, artificial intelligence and transhumanism. Now, artificial intelligence is this, as we said, there's narrow AI we're not too worried about. It's the deep mind. It's trying to model the mind, the human brain, and they're incredibly close now. So you've got this thinking thing, okay, this intelligence that thinks for itself and acts for itself. And if that takes control over us, and I'm going to show you how I believe that's going to happen, I believe that's a big problem. And if you put that into a robot, for simplistic sake, that is a huge problem. Humanism is this wonderful thing where, well, in order to catch up with the robots, we're going to change bits of us. We're going to make ourselves more intelligent. We're going to plug things into us. Or we're going to be immersed in virtual reality. And it's going to be this wonderful vista where we're going to fly and see wonderful different worlds. I would beg to differ. If we're lucky, that's how it'll end up, if we're lucky. Okay, at least we're alive. Well, let's dig into the science. This guy here, who's this guy? Well, he's a very bright chemist. And he said, we've already created the blueprint for innovated a cyborg tissue. Who remembers Doctor Who? The cyborgs. And recently shown how electronics can be injected into and intermingled with the brain. What they do is they use a needle, they go into the skull, it's a very tiny needle, and there's a mesh, and it unfolds, and it links your brain up to the internet. Okay? Already doing it, and the immune system is tolerating it really well. It's very advanced. Well, if he was no one, well, you maybe don't believe him. He was recognized as the leading chemist in the world. Okay? And what you need to understand is this is not a little thing. And they're already working on connecting brains. They do this with rats, and they can have the rats thousands of miles apart, and once they connect their brains, they work as one. Okay, they're already doing, and they call it brain net. You understand it as something else, hive mind. This guy is an English, he's a tenured professor, I think, university, I think that might be Birmingham, University of West of England. And he said, personal computing, these are the guys doing this work now in your own country. Personal computing will become intrapersonal and intracellular. Each human neuron will be hijacked by a self-growing, self-repairing molecular network. Computers will be networks of polymer filaments growing inside and together with a human. Seeds of the networks will be injected into the embryos in the first month of their development. They will form a gigantic network inside the brain. Computers will be inside us. They will span all living creatures in a united computing network, which is a hive mind. And initially, when this takes off, and this is happening, there's nothing that's going to stop this at the moment. As it takes off, some of us will say we don't want anything to do with it. Once they get going, you were going to have to be a part of this. Now, in order to inject your embryo, they have to have your permission. But if we're all going to be a part of this, they have to override that. So maybe you've got an understanding now why they're so keen to bring mandatory vaccination in, is to get that mandatory thing going and get you used to having medical intervention, I would suggest. There's other guys here. This guy was looked at as a bit of a joke at first, but he's very serious, and he was running for governor. I don't think, obviously, he didn't win. And he's saying, look, you know, it's time to get rid of this boring human body, all these illnesses and stuff. We just want to live forever. University of Oxford published, I mean, these are serious authors. They're saying, well, what we need to do is we need to copy the brainwaves, and we need to emulate them and build trillions and trillions of copies in this kind of virtual world, and that will be wonderful. But what about us? I mean, it's just insane, and this is going on. Now, put this up. Obviously, I'm not going to talk about the guy in the middle, but it's a good excuse because he talks about passion and perseverance. Two other people have got that is Elon Musk and Ray Kurzweil, and these are the two known faces of all of this. And Elon Musk, I'm going to talk about first. He formed Tesla and SpaceX Foundation. Now, there's a link between transhumanism and space, and I'll tell you that in a second. And Neuralink is the company. They're interested in using this thing where you inject the skull and this mesh unfolds, okay? So, and what he's saying is problem, reaction, solution. AI is a problem. We're not going to be able to compete, so we've got to change, and that's where transhumanism comes in. Now, what he said at the world government recently in Dubai, he said, people would, listen to the language, people would need to become cyborgs to be relevant in a future dominated by AI. He said a merger of biological intelligence and machine intelligence would be necessary for humans to stay economically valuable. This, you're going to see the language of the... I'm not sure about him. I said that over a meal. I've still got hopes for this guy. The others, not so much. Listen, this is one of his great ideas.
Terraforming is the hypothetical process of altering a planet's environment to make it livable. Tesla CEO Elon Musk recently floated the idea that Mars could be terraformed through nuclear strikes to destroy its polar ice caps. The average temperature on Mars is similar to Antarctica in winter. Destroying the poles may warm the planet, but scientists told the Los Angeles Times this may not warm Mars enough and could lead to unknown changes in its terrain.
I mean, who was I talking to? I think it was Mike. I said, if you went to work in Tesco's, and he said, oh, what do you do? I said, I've got a great idea. I said, what's that? He said, I think we should nuke Mars. I mean, they'd go, next. You couldn't get a job as a shelf filler, could you, if you did that? And, okay, so that's the first guy. The second guy, the second genius is this guy. Now, he wrote a chapter in this book. And in this book, The Scientific Conquest for Death, it will be routine practice to have billions of nanobots coursing through the capillaries of our brains, communicating with each other, as well as with our biological neurons and with the internet. One application would be to immerse you into virtual reality. Now, he didn't say, oh, by the way, can I ask you your permission if you'd like to do that? What he's saying is, people talk about smart dust and they talk about it incorrectly, but what he's really saying is this stuff will be ubiquitous in the air, and when you breathe it in, it will perform this task in your body. And no one's asked you if you want to give permission for that. And if you don't understand that in plain English there, nanobots will plug our brains into the web by the 2030s. And this is a serious, serious guy. And lots of money has been put behind this guy. So I looked into him. I like to know the background to these people. And he said, listen to the language. This was in Rolling Stone, an interview. Death represents the loss of knowledge and information. Is that what death means to you? He said, a person is a mind file. A person is a software program, a very profound one, and we have no backup. So when our hardware dies, our software dies with it. He is leading the world at the moment, and he is setting the direction. He said, I've made an issue of overcoming death, and the strongest experience I've had with death is as a tragedy. This is where you get to the nuts and bolts. His most ambitious plan for life after the singularity, which is the merging of us with his technology, however, is also his most personal. Using technology, he plans to bring his dead father back to life. I think there's another word for that. We can find some of his DNA around the gravesite. That's a lot of information right there. The AI will send down some nanobots and get some bone or teeth and extract some DNA and put it all together. Then they'll get some information from my brain and anyone else who still remembers it. I mean, this is insanity. This guy, with the greatest respect to this man, Google this guy is in charge of your future. That's it. Obviously, others have disagreed. This is Faye Voschel, who's a theologian, a clever one, and she said, look, these tech honchos would have an outrageous level of control over humanity. A technological elite comprised of demigods who decide how the rest of us think and act by programming us may well result in abuse and deformations as severe as those depicted in the Isle of Dr. Moreau. What you're looking at is technocracy. I don't have time to go into that. Out of Colombo, 1930s. Don't have time. It's Hubbard, M.K. Hubbard. Another article by Sylvia Lazarus, referencing Professor Fukuyama, political scientist and economist at Stanford. He said, transhumanism, you defined it as one of the most dangerous ideas in the world. Absolutely. What would happen when humans and post-humans coexist in the same world? What sort of interactions would occur between the two distinct species and even between humans who are at different levels of enhancement? This is so true, it's so simple, but so profound. In our interaction with animals, we assume a superior rationality. This idea leads us to think that we have more rights than them, even the right to kill them. How would this pattern of behavior apply to a situation in which some post-humans recognize that they have a superior rationality compared to normal humans? And he says, the issue here is one of democracy, is absolutely right. If not everyone can or wants to receive the same level of enhancement, human rights may be threatened. The same issue of superiority would apply to the question of inequality. Some people might be able to afford becoming exponentially more intelligent than others, with the consequence of being able to control those who can't or don't want this enhancement. You have no idea of how right that man is. Where does it all come from? If you go back to the Greek myths, you've got Medea, her name means to devise. Who remembers Jason the Argonauts? Remember that as a kid watching that? Well, he kind of fell under a spell, and he wanted his father to be invigorated, so she drew all the blood out of his veins and stuck herbs in them and made him glow with health. And this, you start to see these myths, this concept of extending life or changing life. And of course, you've got Archytas, who was Plato's mate in 400 BC, and he caused a sensation with a mechanical steam-propelled bird. You've got other artisans who built figures that opened doors, poured drinks, and even attacked humans. And then you've got the many-headed hydra, yeah, which every time you tried to chop one off, two more heads grew. And then you've got, eventually, Hercules had to stick a boulder on it because he couldn't kill this thing, and then it oozed and poisoned the land. And there's another series of myths credited to Daedalus, who's a genius of Crete, because you had Prometheus, who wanted to live forever, and he said, okay, we'll let you live forever, but your liver's going to have to be pecked every single day. And it was pecked by this drone-like eagle that was made. So if you look through these myths, and of course you've got the giant bronze statue that bled, sweated, and all the rest of it, and there was even a thing called a biomimetic cow that mated with a real bull, and it produced a minotaur, which I think was a human body with some kind of bull's head, and eventually had to be killed. What the myths are telling us is don't screw around with this stuff, because it might just not work out the way you think it's going to work out. But obviously, a few people, including Mr. Musk and others, have not listened. Now, this is a 630 BC vase, okay? And if you look here, can you see this lamb coming out of the cauldron of rejuvenation? Yeah, now that predates, this is an article, that predates by 2,000 or 3,000 years Dolly the sheep. You know about Dolly the sheep, the genetically engineered sheep? Interesting. And, well, here's the real one. That's called ectogenesis. That is a lamb. Sorry, that's a goat, same difference, being born by scientists. Have you guys ever heard me speaking about this before? Anyone? Did you know that happened? And did you also know that's probably the way kids are going to be born, probably within your lifetime? Yeah. So you've got that, which is 2,000 or 3,000 years ago. Then you've got that, and that's very interesting. But, and the word ectogenesis, who came up with that name? Do you know? Professor Haldane from Oxford. He predicted this over 90 odd years ago. And do you know who his mate was? His mate was Aldous Huxley. How do you think Aldous Huxley knew about all this stuff? And interesting enough, they all belong to certain organizations called the Fabian Society and things like that. That is a whole other discussion. But he knew because he was told by the man who knew a long, long, long time ago. But what did the Russians ever do for us? I'm not going to mention Donald Trump, the Russian. Okay, there's another link from the Greeks, and it goes through Christian philosophers. And what they were saying was, well, we want to get to heaven, but we can't wait. So what do we do? So maybe we can work some kind of mechanical way of getting to heaven. And you kind of saw that a little bit with the Greeks. They were trying to work out how they transcended humanity, how they changed things. Well, you've got that. I haven't got time to get into that, but we'll talk about the Russians. You've got these three guys you may never have heard of, but these three guys are absolutely the reason why we're in this mess now. And they formed something called Cosmism. And really what it was kind of late 19th, early 20th century, and it was a cultural movement. It was kind of mixing kind of philosophy, East and West, but it had a large dollop of Russian Orthodox Christianity. And many of the ideas have been adopted now in the transhumanist movement. And the first guy, Konstantin Tsiolkovsky, who I'm completely wrong, but I pretend I know what I'm saying with a name, he is credited as being the pioneer of space travel. So this is not some lightweight, certainly in Russia. And he believed that if you could go to other planets, you could expand the human race and perfect it, very much like Musk. Yeah. The next guy, Vladimir Vernadsky, now he saw the Christian notion of love as something he called neugenesis. And he wanted to use nuclear processes to kind of transmutate us. And he believed it all culminate in this Omega point where Christ would be reborn, as it were. And it's pretty much like the singularity. And the other guy, Fedorov, once again, Orthodox Christian philosopher, talked about radical life extension, physical immortality, and all the rest of it. And he also said, look, we shouldn't just stick bits on us, we should transmutate so we could fly and go to deep space. Now, the key to a lot of these guys is they're talking about religion. It's religion, it's God. Okay, now Fedorov, there's a big monument to him. The BBC did a program and said, look, this guy was probably the father of the Soviet space project. Certain books came out, The Quantum Thief, and they talked about uploaded minds called Sonos, and they were inspired by him. And another book was inspired by him as well, talked about implanting minds into another body. This is like 100 years ago, these guys were coming up with these ideas. Those ideas are the ideas at the forefront of Ray Kurzweil. Did you know that? They want to implant your mind, they want to take your mind and put it into a digital world. If you don't know that, that's exactly where these guys are headed. Now, why have I told you that? This is a really good article by Rushkoff, and he goes into detail, because what happened was, these cosmists were taken to Silicon Valley, and they had a kind of weekend away there, where they had hot tub sessions and parties and group thinks and all the rest of it. And so the technologists in Silicon Valley came into direct contact with the cosmists, okay? And what they said was, well, these guys are probably the first to think of transcendence as a problem of engineering. He go on, and he says, at this, one of the guys was quoted, who was at these kind of meetings, he said, at best, we brainwashed ourselves and each other, this is the Silicon Valley guys and these Russians, at worst, we embedded with a set of really weird memes, which then went on to guide our leading technologists. That's why Google, this is the point, lost interest in organizing the world's information and is now so intent on developing AI and a server cloud for Kurzweil. Now, Kurzweil is the guy that wants to bring his dead father back to life. Silicon Valley is enacting a religious prophecy. Thinking and feeling robots are just a technologist's version of angels. So this is it. This is where it happened. Okay? And this is the reason why we're in the crapple. That's the medical terminology, by the way. I want you to listen. I'm very quickly going to go. Listen to the language. This is another British academic who is a proponent of transhumanism. He wrote a book, co-authored a book on it, called The Proactionary Imperative. Listen to his language. Perhaps the most potent argument against suicide in modern secular societies is that it constitutes a wasted of the agent's own life. However, the force of this argument could be mitigated if the suicide occurred in the context of experimentation, including self-experimentation with very risky treatments that aim to extend the human condition. Suicide in these cases could be quite informative and hence significantly advance the prospects of the rest of humanity. The suicide agent's life would most certainly not have been in vain. Cutting-edge enhancement research is currently conducted on non-humans and or simulated on computers, but it's generally agreed that that real change will only come from monitoring human uses of the relevant enhancement treatments. But as long as that research ethics code for human subjects continue to dwell in the shadow of the Nuremberg trials, a very high bar will be set on what counts as informed consent. Are you hearing what I'm hearing? You know, that pesky Nuremberg trials, that was a bit of a problem to create a high bar for universities. The only reason for such a high bar is the insurance premiums that universities and other research institutes would need to bear if they liberalized the terms on which subjects could offer themselves in a service of risky enhancement research. With the greatest respect to that man, I cannot believe what I'm reading. The actual outcomes of such experiments need not be death. This is a professor in England saying this, okay, in one of the universities. Just as the actual outcomes of suicide attempts are often not death, nevertheless, the agent will be treating the prospect of suicide in the spirit of self-sacrifice. Not so very different from citizens who volunteer to join the military service, knowing for well they may need to give up their life at some point. In this way, the moral stigma surrounding suicide will be removed. Indeed, in a truly progressive society, because we're not progressive, because we wouldn't want suicide people to do that, this route to suicide may come to be seen as a legitimate lifestyle choice, one that might even become popular if and when death comes to be medically reversible. Are you hearing the language of people that are involved in transhumanism? My modest proposal is that the taboos on suicide be lifted, such that potential experimental subjects who are told that their chance of survival are very uncertain may nevertheless agree to participate with limited liability borne by the institution to conduct the research. And the bottom line is that individuals should be presumed capable, and to have proven otherwise, of setting the level of risk which they are willing to tolerate, even including a level that implies a much higher likelihood of death than most people would tolerate. Such people have the makings of becoming the true heroes of the transhumanist movement. If someone wants to commit suicide, you say, can I do an experiment on you? Because if you do, I can live longer. Or would you say, let's help you? What's wrong? How can we help you understand? Am I insane? Time and time again, listen to the language of the people. Now, originally, the ascent to God was spiritual religious. Then it got changed into religion mechanical. Then the cosmists come along, it's religion engineering. Now it's gone digital. And the God part is gone. The spiritual part is no more, okay? And I put the arrow going down because I don't think they're transcending anywhere soon. I think they're going the wrong way. But does the future need us? What do you think? Well, this guy's answered it. This was a Wired article, Why the Future Doesn't Need Us. This is Bill Joy, co-founder and chief scientist of Sun Microsystems. Check this out. This is him. From the moment I became involved in the creation of new technologies, their ethical dimensions have concerned me. I can date the onset of my unease to the day I met Ray Kurzweil, the guy that wants to dig up his dead father, the head of Google. Ray and I were both speakers at Telecosm Conference, and I encountered him by chance at the bar. I was sitting with John Searle, who's a Berkeley philosopher who studies consciousness, and while we were talking, Ray approached and a conversation began, the subject of which haunts me to this day. Ray was saying that the rate of improvement of technology was going to accelerate and that we were going to become robots or fuse with robots. John, countering that this couldn't happen because the robots couldn't be conscious, and I'd always felt sentient robots were in the realms of science fiction, but now, from someone I respected, I was hearing a strong argument that they were a near-term possibility. I was taken aback, especially given Ray's proven ability to imagine and create the future. This guy's got an incredible success rate, Ray Kurzweil, for predicting the future. Ray gave me a partial preprint of his then forthcoming book, The Age of Spiritual Machines, which outlined a utopia he foresaw. And on reading it, my sense of unease only intensified. He had to be understating the dangers, understating the probability of a bad outcome. And I found myself most troubled by a passage detailing a dystopian scenario. He then goes on to talk about this passage, and it's from a treatise from 1995 by another professor. Now, I'm going to quote you some of that treatise. This is the guy, Professor Kaczynski. This was taken in 67. He was the youngest professor at Berkeley. He went to Harvard at a very young age. He was a genius. When he did his PhD, the guy that vived him said, geez, there's only 10 people in the whole of America who could even understand what this guy's going on about. That's how clever he was. This is what he wrote, published in the Wall Street Journal, I think. This is 172. I'm going to read this and listen to this. This is what he was writing 20-odd years ago. First, let us postulate that the computer scientists succeed in developing intelligent machines that can do all things better than human beings can do them. In that case, presumably, all work will be done by vast, highly organized systems of machines, and no human effort will be necessary. Either of two cases might occur. The machines might be permitted to make all their own decisions without human oversight, or else human control over the machines might be retained. If the machines are permitted to make all their own decisions, we can't make any conjectures as to the results because it is impossible to guess how such machines might behave. We only point out that the fate of the human race would be at the mercy of the machines. It might be argued that the human race would never be foolish enough to hand over all power to the machines. But we are suggesting, this is very important, neither that the human race would voluntarily turn power over to the machines, nor that the machines would willfully seize power. What we do suggest is that the human race might easily permit itself to drift into a position of such dependence on the machines that it would have no practical choice but to accept all of the machines' decisions. As society and the problems that face it become more and more complex, and as machines become more and more intelligent, people will let machines make more and more of their decisions for them, and simply because machines make better decisions and will bring better results. Eventually, a stage may be reached at which the decisions necessary to keep the system running will be so complex that human beings will be incapable of making them intelligently. At that stage, the machines will be ineffective control. People won't be able to just turn the machines off because they will be so dependent on them that turning them off would amount to suicide. I think those 39 words there, I think it's 39 words, are probably going to be the most profound words said in the 21st century. And, of course, you know him as someone else, don't you? And he also goes and talks more, and some other stuff as well. He also talks about if the elite is okay with us, then maybe they'll engineer us so that we can have no real need or desire to do anything. If they're not, goodbye. And you're absolutely right. The person who shouted that out is the Unabomber. Incredible. We certainly don't condone anyone using violence, but I tell you what, history may look differently on this man. This paper, I actually know no one ever listens to me because I went onto a radio and talked about this paper and no one mentioned it anywhere after I talked about it. I was shocked. This paper came out last year. I'm going to summarize it for you, just showing you a little bit about it. Last year under Obama, the White House challenged the nanotechnology and computing science communities to look beyond the decades-old approach to computing to address building more complex systems to allow advanced robots to work safely alongside people. Okay, so this is not a joke anymore. I'll summarize this. This is the kicker. Technology that enables trusted and secure operations of complex platforms, energy or weapon systems that require software or combination of multiple codes so complicated that it exceeds a human's ability to write and verify the software and its performance. So if humans aren't going to be writing and doing it, who's going to be doing it? Now, these machines are already speaking and talking to each other in a way that we don't understand. And we are about to hand everything over to them. This is either a biggest joke on the planet, or it's the worst sci-fi movie script I've ever seen. This is even, I mean, does no one ever go to the movies in the White House? Did they not see Terminator, for God's sake? They want this software to deter, detect, protect, and adapt. They want it to observe, orient, decide, and act. And it's for process both for military and civilian purposes, such as transportation, medicine, scientific discovery, exploration, disaster, everything. This thing is going to control everything. They're telling you, this is an official document from the US government. And I'm just going to quickly show you this. There is an absolute vast city of programs involved in this. IBM True North, DARPA's Upside Down, DARPA's Synapse, and NESF Core programs, blah, 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 and on and on and on. The Brain Initiative program in Europe, IAPA Micron's program, and on and on and on. There's stacks of it. There's universities here involved in this. Now, they've set goals. Now, do you remember when the jobs were going to go? 10 to 15 years? Here's their five-year goal. This is now 4 years, because this document's a year old. Autonomous capabilities for routine attack scenarios to be achieved, and human-machine augmented capabilities. How has no one even quoted this document? Or how come I'm the only person who's speaking about this document? What the hell is a human-machine augmented capability? Parallel goals. Identify and reverse engineer, they want to reverse engineer the brain. And at 15 years, which is now 14 years away, enabled large-scale design, output designs that could be prototyped into hardware. They're talking 15 years for this thing to be up and running. 15 years, exactly the same time as there'll be no jobs. Coincidence? That's it. It's in black and white with yellow highlight. But it would never happen, would it? There you go. It started. So you don't have to have a dystopian future where robots are taking over the world by force. If we just depend more and more and more, and we actually don't know what these things are doing, and this stuff is so freaking complicated that they're the only things who can do it, how the hell is that going to end well? But some people love it. Oh, look at this, the amalgamation of man and machine. Isn't this a utopian life? I don't believe it is. Stephen Hawking has woken up and said, this may not be a good idea. I think it might destroy the human race. But the solution, according to him, well, what we need is some form of world government. To his credit, he said there might become a tyranny. But you've got human rights, haven't you? But so have they. Recently voted, 17 people to 2 voted to give robots rights. Did you know that? This is within the last few months or so. So basically they're debating whether you've got the right to beat a robot and all the rest of it. This is, here's the document. I'm living in a mad world. I have no idea what's going on. But don't forget simple stuff, like Wi-Fi. 200 scientists talked about this and said, look, we're not safe from it, it causes all these problems. I'm just going to concentrate on that virtual technology there. This is an experiment. Even ignoring the microwave radiation, they put this phone in front of a kid, a young kid, and said, what does it do to this kid? The light itself can cause damage to the retina, because up to the age of 20, the lens isn't tinted enough with yellow to be able to filter it very well. Then you get into what does it do? You've got areas of the brain like the hypothalamus and hippocampus. In a kid, it absorbs much, much more radiation. And the cerebellum and their bone, in their skulls, the marrow absorbs up to 10 times what we absorb. And we shouldn't be absorbing anything. These areas are to do with long-term memory. They're to do with areas that are damaged in child abuse. They're to do with areas that are damaged in dementia. Okay? And you've got a kid in front of a phone all day long on these things. Not good. So what should you do? Airplane mode, a limited time of exposure. You shouldn't let a kid on for that stuff for more than 10 or 15 minutes, and really, not before the age of 12. We've all done it now, certainly not under the age of 2. But you're going to see a lot about virtual reality. You're going to hear about it in healthcare, and they're going to say it's wonderful. It really isn't that great. There's a couple of things it might help for, but it's very limited technology. They're only using it for a very limited time. Now, this is what you need to understand. You see all these people with these virtual goggles on? Yeah, all this stuff? This paper here, look at this. In a normal population, immersion in... Now, the reason I'm telling you that this is AI, to immerse you into this virtual reality, so I'm going to tell you what it's going to do to your brain. And they know this. Immersion in the virtual, in a VE, virtual environment, enhances self-reported dissociative symptoms on subsequent re-exposure to the real environment, indicating that VR, virtual reality, does indeed modulate the neural mechanisms underpinning presence. So when you go into this stuff, you're fine in it. The minute you come back into the real world, you don't know where you are. So it's causing changes to your brain. The chronic expression of these symptoms, they call it depersonalization disorder, there's a derealization as well, is characterized by alteration in the perception or experience of the self, so that one feels detached from and as if one is an outside observer of one's own mental processes. This is the stuff they're putting onto the kids, and this is the stuff they want us all to do. Notably, DPD is often accompanied by alexithymia, which refers to a deficiency in understanding, processing, or describing emotions. More generally, a deficiency of conscious access to subjective emotional states. Now, I'm going to introduce the concept of three gates. You've got the gate that takes you out into the cognitive well. You've got the gate that's internal, that allows you to process things, and there's a religious spiritual gate as well. And what you're seeing is these gates, these access to these parts, are being systematically damaged, and may even be irreversibly damaged. And this is, we're just on the precipice of this stuff. God knows when you get really into it. Now, studies reveal significantly lower activation of the anterior insular cortex and the bilateral cingulate cortex as compared to normal controls when viewing aversive images. What this is doing is suppressing your normal human response to horrible things. That's called a sociopath or a psychopath. So your humanity makes you care for people, gives you empathy. These things are suppressing that. All right, now remember that, because that's important when we get onto the spiritual stuff a bit later. It's been suggested that DPD is associated with a suppressive mechanism grounded in the frontal limbic brain region. This is your human part of your brain, notably the AIC, which manifests subjectively as emotional numbing and disables the process by which perception and cognition become emotionally colored, giving rise to a subjective feeling of unreality. Now, that's the science. This is the kind of street version. When Tobias slips on his virtual reality headset to play Google's Tilt Brush, he becomes a god. His fingertips become a fiery paintbrush in the sky, and a flick of the wrist rotates the clouds, and he can jump effortlessly from one world to another. The problem is, when the headset comes off, though, it's back to a dreary reality. And lately, Van Schneiber has been noticing some unsettling lingering effects. What stays is a strange feeling of sadness and disappointment when participating in the real world. Usually on the same day, the sky seems less colorful, and it just feels like I'm missing the magic. I feel deeply disturbed and often end up just sitting there staring at a wall. There's kids that have been playing these games, and they're shaking them, and it takes them half an hour to kind of get them back into reality. There are dozens of stories like this, from kind of fuzzy feelings to dreamlike states. And he said, one evening during my depersonalization, derealization phase, he'd come off this stuff, I was riding in a cab down a main street in the West Village, looking out the window. It was a summer's day, and there were tourists everywhere, and the light before sunset was still lingering. It was a perfect time to be out in the street, walking with friends and family, and taking in New York City. But I remember the distinct feeling of hating everyone I saw. They had brains that just worked. Brains that collected streams of sensory information and painted a satisfying picture of reality, just like brains are supposed to do. They most likely never questioned if what they were experiencing was real. An Australian video game journalist also said, I was very fatigued, I felt dizzy, and it definitely hits that strange point where the real world feels surreal. And this is the reality of what that science says. And they say, I'm not going to go into depth, but other people are experiencing this as well. And when you take mice and you put them in a virtual room, their GPS doesn't work. They can't map that room. But when they go into the real world, they can. And you can really get into this. But the reality is, what you're seeing is the brain is being changed by this. Okay? This isn't a free lunch. And you are becoming, and the part that's being changed is the part that makes you human. And it's the part that allows you to access the outside world. And what you're going to get from me is, I'm going to tell you, you are designed to be in the outside world. You are designed to be moving in the outside world. Big movements. Okay, not little movements on computers all day. Okay, so what we need is a disruption. Yeah, are you prepared for a disruption? Well, this is from a Trans-Human magazine, and listen to the language. Change in the direction of humanity is inevitable. Whether Trans-Human or post-human, we are unlikely to be the humans of recent history in the immediate future that lies ahead. No one asked us if they wanted to do that. The disruption to normal human life is profound in implication and consequence, from communication to life-changing technologies. The fabric of human existence is being fundamentally disrupted and re-engineered. And they talk about using disruption as a technique. The level of change from accepted norms, which hopefully most of us here would like, will undoubtedly face unprecedented resistance, and an extended periods of turbulence is expected in this transitional twilight. Studies suggest that only approximately 1/4 of us actively engage and welcome change, while the remainder either go with the flow or resist. To prevent a protracted transitional period of uncertainty and unrest, it is therefore imperative that the change agents pursue a cohesive strategy of disruptive evolution. There are reams of this stuff. There are organizations, I haven't got time to get actively doing this. How many organizations have you got to keep humanity as it is? There you go. They do graphs. I'm not going to get into all of that, but look. Regressive, that's us, we're regressive. Look at the language, not normal people, you are regressive, and the progressive ones are them. And they go into about how many people believe this might happen and blah, blah, blah. Okay, but these are all the chapters. This is just one organization. See them all? All actively pushing politically and everything else to move this agenda forward. How many of you are involved in stuff to stop this, if you believe you should? I'm not gonna put my opinion on you, but I think we should. And this is what they say. If you want to become an H-plus activist, look, write about transhumanism from the popular non-transhumanist press. Not the press. Listen to the language. They're non-transhumanist press. They've already decided. What's happening to our children? You've already had an idea. I've told you what the mobile phones are doing. I've told you what those Google glasses are doing. And the whole nine, not just Google, but whoever's doing virtual reality glasses. You haven't got to read this. This is just to show you this research. Stacks of research. National Assessment of Education reported deficiencies in higher order reasoning skills, including those necessary for advanced reading, comprehension, math, and science. Other ones, only 5% of high school graduates could satisfactorily master material traditionally used at college level. And it's no surprise that 80% of the books in the United States are read by 10% of the people. And typical fifth graders, what percentage of time they spend reading? 50% read 4 minutes a day, or less, 30%, 2 minutes a day, and 10% read nothing. They call them alliterates. They can read, but they don't. They watch television for their news and achieve only a superficial level of understanding. And they may sound out words, and a teacher said this the other day without even prompting, but they don't really understand them as well. And several of the teachers interviewed said, from every neighborhood that comes to class, they come with fewer social skills, less language ability, less ability to listen, less motor ability, and in general, a frightening majority of children's attention spans have degenerated. Other studies back that up, and they conclude that this is the kicker. Statistical and dramatic changes in cognitive, motor, and academic forms. Cognitive and motor. Your ability to have a cognitive ability in your brain to work in this three-dimensional world is absolutely linked to your ability to move. Okay? As we become upright creatures, this is the difference. And this is when the frontal part of the brain really developed. And it's developed alongside this motor. If you're not moving, your brain will not be healthy. And you see someone with dementia, one of the first signs of dementia is you see that left arm not move when they walk. And I was with my wife the other day, I said, look, dementia's coming. And you see the left arm not work. The right brain, right and left brain, it's an easy way of understanding. It's a lot more complex than that. But the right brain is majorly deficient globally. Right brain, the seat of hope. And you see it in that left arm. Motoristic, you have to move. If your kids are not chucked out in the garden on trampolines and moving, you are doing them no service at all. In fact, you're doing them a disservice. And they go on and on and on. They talk about causes of this. And I'll just share this law. Mum's not been around so much. And they go on some other stuff. VCR, which is then, but now it's computer games and sedentary behavior. Now, recent study. Peter Gray, PhD, quoting Professor Kim, talking about the Torrance test of creative thinking. They collected data over several decades from school children. According to his analysis, the scores on the test at all grade levels began to decline somewhere in the 80s and 90s. And it's massive drops. Okay. And what he said is this. Indicate that children have become less emotionally expressive, less energetic, less talkative and verbally expressive, less humorous, less imaginative, less unconventional, less lively and passionate, less perceptive, less apt to connect seemingly irrelevant things, and less synthesizing and less likely to see things from a different angle. Well, surprise, surprise. For several decades, we as a society have been suppressing children's freedom to ever greater extents. And now we find that their creativity is declining. Creativity is nurtured by freedom and stifled by the continuous monitoring, evaluation, adult direction, and pressure to conform that restrict children's lives today. In the real world, few questions have one right answer. Few problems have one right solution. That's why creativity is crucial to success in the real world. But more and more, we are subjecting children to an educational system that assumes one right answer to every question and one correct solution to every problem. A system that punishes children and their teachers too for daring to try different routes. We're also increasingly depriving children of free time outside of school to play, explore, be bored, overcome boredom, fail, overcome failure, that is, to do all that they must do in order to develop their full creative potential. Who agrees with that? That's what we see, don't we, at schools? Big gates, Ofsted, outstanding, that central control. This obviously goes back to the 50s, if you understand that side of the narrative. I haven't got time to get into that. And this is also a kind of metaphor, this prison is a kind of prison of their minds. Our kids have been absolutely screwed up. And there's other things. You can argue back and forth, but IQs and stuff, it's not good. I call this the silo world. The silo world, okay? We've gone from being interactive and now three-dimensional, and we are being absolutely closed. And as we close in our ability, our brains close. And as we, our motoricity and our ability to act in the real closes, so our humanity declines, because they're absolutely linked. Not just that, what about antibiotics? If you get antibiotics early on in life, even low dose, do you know you increase problems with the brain, neurodevelopmental problems with the brain? Can have lifelong consequences just by giving antibiotics early on in life. And why? Because it causes damages to the gut. The gut expresses these things called chemokines or interleukins. You get expression in the brain, it causes damage to the human part of the brain. You need to know this, especially if you're pregnant or you know someone that's pregnant. MIA is the maternal immune activation. And basically what it means is this. If you activate it inappropriately in a female around pregnancy, then it's linked to problems not only as kids, neurodevelopmental problems, but also as adults. and even to things like Parkinson's and Alzheimer's. Now, how does that happen? If you're a female and you're pregnant and you get an infection, your immune system will rev up, and if it's a certain time or stage of pregnancy, things that are released during that stage may damage the child's brain, and that brain may be, that baby may be born and not be able to interact properly in the world. Now, they did lots of studies on this, and they said, well, what causes this? Is it the infection or the immune system? And it's definitely the immune system, so it's not the infection. And it's this thing called IL-6. Can you see there, IL-6? When that's expressed inappropriately during pregnancy, it can cause damage. What the kind of damage? Cognitive flexibility gets damaged, your ability to act in the three-dimensional world as a human. Things like selective attention, social behavior, your ability to react with others, explorative behavior and working memory, as well as increased sensitivity to psychomimetic drugs. Can you see the correlation between that and some of the things that that other study found at school? Okay, can you see where all these things start to interact? Screwing with their minds. Now, they did another study, and they said, right, well, that's fine. What else might cause a problem? And they found this molecule called IL-17A, interleukin, and that's the one that goes in and causes the damage to the developing brain. And they know because they blocked all of this with antibodies. Now, why is this important, IL-6 and IL-17A? Because guess what? When you give a flu vaccine, okay, what does it do? It raises IL-6. Now, the logic behind the flu vaccine, allegedly, is, well, if a pregnant woman gets flu, she's at danger of having damage to her child, so we'll give everyone a vaccine. But the infection is not the problem. So if you've got 1 million women, some get an infection, and some of them have this damage, that's not nice. But if you vaccinate 1 million women, you raise their immune system, and you raise the very thing that may cause the damage. So the logic there is the wrong way around. Oh, look, they postulate that it might cause a problem, but they always poo-poo it and say, no, it doesn't. This is a paper that talks about making vaccines. And they're patting each other on the back. Look, the formulation of this vaccine with aluminum hydroxide resulted in a stable vaccine that induced both antibodies and IL-17. So the vaccine, they're patting themselves on the back that they're producing the thing we've just shown that causes damages to the developing fetus. And these experiments underscore the importance of formulation studies with aluminium containing adjuvants for the development of stable. So they say, look, get that aluminium in there. It raises that molecule. And if they actually just took their eye off that paper and opened up another one, they could see that's not a good idea. What about paracetamol? Paracetamol suppresses the part of the brain that gives you empathy. Yeah, just like the games and just all the other stuff. However, I'm not saying don't ever use a painkiller. I'm saying be judicious in how you use it. Let's briefly talk about consciousness. Who said this? The most beautiful and most profound emotion we can experience is the sensation of the mystical. It is at the root of all true science. Someone to whom this emotion is a stranger, who can no longer stand wrapped in awe, is as good as dead. That deeply emotional conviction of the presence of a superior reasoning power, which is revealed in the incomprehensible universe, is my idea of God. Who said that? There you go. There's some clever people in the audience. This is, I could pick any book, this is just one. Many religions may make the same claim, but the reality is they all too often the spirituality taught by the founder of those religions has been lost. This is not a religious debate, okay, don't get me on that one. Or obscured by dogma and ritual. There are profound differences between the teachings of Christ and the practices of mainstream Christianity, between what Krishna taught and Hinduism, between the teachings of the Buddha and Buddhism. The original message was spiritual, but to varying degrees that spirit has been diluted or lost, and through the attempts of less evolved individuals to cloak spiritual concepts in dogma, and through religions becoming religious and political institutions. I think most of us would kind of agree with that. Now, this is just talking about yoga. I could have picked anyone. The philosophy of yoga says there are two different levels to our inner self, mental or emotional self, and our spiritual self. But our real self, the spiritual self, of self-awareness, comes from our connection to a wider, subtler fold of consciousness. The yogic philosophy says there is a reflection of an infinite, all-knowing form of consciousness within our own minds, and that infinite consciousness is unchanging and eternal, and it's the core of our true spiritual self. Now, when we identify with the small ego-centered self, this is called the relative reality. This is the stuff that Bill Gates and those guys are living in, because that small self is prone to change and death. Oh, we've got to change that. We've got to have transhumanism and blah, blah, blah. But when we realize that there's a subtler, permanent reality behind the relative one, and we see that our true nature is pure, unlimited consciousness, this is known as self-realization. This is repeated throughout all cultures. all cultures independent of each other. It cannot be ignored, in my opinion. In the 4th century AD, the deserts of Egypt, Palestine, Arabia, and Persia were peopled by a race of men. They sought a way to God that was uncharted and freely chosen, not inherited from others who had mapped it out beforehand. They sought a God whom they alone could find, not one who was given in a set stereotype form by somebody else. Christian gnosis, which is understood as a gift of the Holy Spirit that enables us to know Christ through meditating on the scriptures and on the cross of Christ. The end of human life and philosophy is to realize that mystical return of the soul to God, freeing itself from the sensuous world by purification, the human soul ascends by successive steps for the various degrees of the metaphysical order and sinks into it. It is the state of ecstasy, Catholic encyclopedia. Wherever you dig, underpinning of this is these teachings. Now, what you want, I mean, this is not a religious debate. I'm not here to argue about that or anything. What your belief is your belief. And underpinning all of that is seclusion and meditation. If you want to get to your God, this is how you transcend, you meditate, or you give service. Okay, now remember what I said about empathy and service? That's the part of the brain that's being changed. And if we look at studies, I'm not into mindfulness. I'm not into that, okay? I would rather, if you're going to do it, you do it from a tradition, but that's just a personal thing. Meditation, relaxed anxiety relief was associated with activation of the anterior cingulate cortex, the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, and the anterior insula. These are the areas I have been describing to you that are being altered and changed through the technology and the drugs, okay? Now, the next study. We investigated brain activity in experienced meditators and matched meditation naive controls as they performed different meditations. We found the main nodes of default mode networks were medial prefrontal, posterior cingulate cortices. Okay, and here's the kicker. Functional connectivity analysis revealed stronger coupling in experienced meditators between the posterior cingulate, dorsal anterior cingulate, and dorsolateral prefrontal cortices, regions previously implicated in self-monitored and cognitive control. These are all the areas that I've just demonstrated to you are being under attack and damaged by the drugs and by the modern technology. Now, if you believe the voluminous amount of text on spirituality, and if you believe that meditation is important, and I must admit I'm persuaded by that evidence, then this is not a good idea to damage those areas of the brain, because you've just been told that that's the way you get, that's the way you transcend. Not by plugging yourself into a Google box, okay? Now, the evidence is there, you may disagree, and I'm not a genius, I just come up with the three gates, not the four gates or the two gates, the three gates. The first gate is the outside world, where you have cognition. I've demonstrated, hopefully clearly, that that is being damaged. Okay, and in some individuals, I think that has been closed irreversibly. I've also demonstrated that the inside world gate is also being damaged, and the last gate is the religious spiritual world. And if you really want me to sum this up, I actually think this technology is building a digital prison for us. I really think it is. Short term, long term, yes, you could imagine some amazing thing would happen, it would all be wonderful, but when you look at it, there are more ways for this to go wrong. And on the balance of probabilities, I don't think the human race is going to survive this. I honestly do not think that. I hope to God I'm wrong. I'm not into religion, but hey, it's evidence. 1 John 4:16, God is love. This love isn't the love, well, I love you, love me. This is the love of real self-realization. You're in that self-realized state, that other dimensional state, and you view the world in a completely different way. Now, why am I telling you all this? Because it would appear this is the route to transcendence. This is the transhuman. This is how it has always been done. Not the way that the egocentric people who are leading this world are saying it. Who knows about Rumi, a 13th century scholar? Love is from the infinite and will remain until eternity. The seeker of love escapes the chains of birth and death. Tomorrow, when resurrection comes, the heart that is not in love will fail the test. And when he says the heart, he doesn't mean the physical heart. There's a subtle system underpinning this we don't have time to get into. Also said, the mind, the small little ego bit, says there's nothing beyond the physical world, so let's plug ourselves in and make robots out of us. The heart says there is, and I've been there many times. He is stating he has experienced this trans-dimensional experience that is the normal route for humans to take throughout all the traditions. And when they talk about this relationship between the guru, if you like, and the disciple, they say it's a gradual illumination of the unconscious mind to reveal the superconscious mind, the universal plan, and the complete evolutionary spectacle. As it is unveiled, the part which the disciple is destined to play becomes clear to him, together with the role with each and every individual is playing. This is the fruition of the guru's consciousness in the disciple, which occurs spontaneously in the process. This is Max Planck, Nobel physicist. I regard consciousness as fundamental. I regard matter as derivative from consciousness. We cannot get behind consciousness. Everything that we talk about, everything that we regard as existing, postulates consciousness. Another Nobel Prize guy. It was not possible to formulate the laws of quantum mechanics in a fully consistent way without reference to consciousness. All these references coming in, not this kind of Newtonian kind of clockwork idea of the world. This was an article, "The Universe is Immaterial, Mental and Spiritual," and it quotes this guy, Sir James Hopwood. "The stream of knowledge is heading towards a non-mechanical reality. The universe begins to look more like a great thought than a great machine. Mind no longer appears to be an accidental intruder into the realm of matter. We ought rather hail it as the creator and governor of the realm of matter." You could spend all day talking about near-death experiences. Consciousness and awareness, this is from a resuscitation journal, talking about people that died on the operating table. Consciousness and awareness appear to occur during a 3-minute period when there was no heartbeat. This is paradoxical, since the brain typically ceases functioning within 20 to 30 seconds of the heart stopping and doesn't resume again until the heart has been restarted. Furthermore, the detailed recollections from the people of visual awareness were consistent with verified events. So they died, but they could tell them what happened. This was a renowned neurosurgeon. He wrote a book called Proof of Heaven. He said, "My coma taught me many things." He went into a coma. "First and foremost, near-death experiences and related mystical states of awareness reveal crucial truths about the nature of existence." He entered into this state, this other dimensional experience, which you get through meditation, under correct guidance. "And the reductive materialist physicalist model on which conventional science is based, and all these people saying we should do this transhuman thing, is fundamentally flawed. At its core, it intentionally ignores what I believe is the fundament of all existence, the nature of consciousness." Which brings us back to these three guys. I put Mr. Gates in there because, hey, what the hell? There's an old Sufi saying. Rumi was a Sufi, and this was a saying. And when they say donkey, the Sufis, they mean the ego. The ego is the donkey that you ride. Your spiritual self rides that donkey and directs it. You need the ego to exist in the world. When it's the other way around, you're going to go in the wrong direction. And I would suggest, at this level of discussion, there is a whole other level of discussion. These men may be incredibly nice people. I have no idea. I'm sure they are. People are going to stone me if I say it. But they are being ruled by their ego. I have hope for Elon Musk. The other two I'm not sure about. Now, I was wondering, how do I end this talk? And I've been pondering how I end this talk. And I'm doing well on time, believe it or not. And I had a day off, and a rare event. I went to the movies with my kids, and I saw this movie. Anyone seen this movie? The boss, go see it. It's a kid's movie. But it's, you know, grab a kid, go see the movie. It's about a perfect family with one child. And they have another baby. And the kid who's already there doesn't want this other baby. He just wants the one child family, okay? So I'm thinking, okay, that's interesting. Population control, blah, blah, blah. And the baby that comes in is actually immortal. And he actually drinks out of his baby bottle this elixir that keeps him immortal. And he's the protagonist, if you like. Anyway, long story short, they have to get on to solve this problem. What's the problem? They have to defeat a psychopath who once was immortal, and he's trying to bring down something called Baby Corp, where babies are made. And in doing so, he's come up with this amazing idea that he's going to make an immortal puppy. And all this this virtual reality in it, where they go to the Baby Corp, there's virtual reality. The one with the suit is the immortal baby. And there's Baby Corp, and here's the cauldron with the immortal. It's interesting, all these little things. You say, oh, my, why are these writers? I wonder if they know what they know. Anyway, long story short, I'm watching this, and it's all going on, and eventually it gets resolved. The immortal baby decides it wants to be mortal. It does it because it falls in love with his brother and his family. And so he gives up immortality. And the theme is that love conquers this thing in him, okay? And it ends with this beautiful music. My wife won't think it's beautiful. I think it's beautiful. And anyway, so this music, the trailer's going, this lovely music's playing. I'll play you in a second. And remember to turn it up for me, Matt, if you can. And also put my mic down, if you don't mind. And anyway, long story short, this music's playing, so the kids, there's only like three families in this cinema. It's been out for ages. My kids get up. The little one is 5, and the other one is 7 and 10, and they run down the front. Have your kids ever done that? They run down the front by the cinema, and they start dancing. And that little bit, it's really sweet. It's lovely. And there's a little stage, and then they jump up on the stage. And say, oh, God, keep away from the screen. And they're dancing away, and they're twirling, and this lovely music's playing. And I just had that lovely moment of looking at the bliss of children. I just think how lovely it is. And this music was playing. And I'm watching them dance. Can you just put it off for a second? And I'm watching them dance, and I'm just thinking, this is so lovely. And then as I'm looking, anyone who does this work, and you guys, you get that feeling in the back of your head, oh my God, all this stuff that's going on in the world. And I'm just thinking, what will their future be? Will they see the beauty of humanity? And this is all going through my head. Or will we see all the crap and the horror that's happened to children all over the years, and will it continue? And as I was watching this, these were the things that were flashing through my mind.
Now, the other event that's happened in Syria recently that has hit the headlines was the bus bombing. You were in Aleppo just the day before,
we actually arrived the day it happened. We actually arrived about an hour after it had happened.
So what can you tell us about that event then?
Minutes after that, she said that they opened the doors to the buses, they allowed off the young men and the children. And again, the man appeared with the plastic bags full of chips, and of course the children swarmed towards him, and that was when the explosion went off. So this was a clear luring of the children to their slaughter.
Video shows the moment of Saturday's blast near Aleppo. The death toll in the bombing of a bus convoy in Syria has now reached 126.
Horrifyingly, two witnesses told me that immediately after the explosion, the women, the mothers of these children, were allowed off the buses for 10 minutes. And during that 10 minutes, she said, Zainab, one of the mothers, told me, she still has 10 relatives missing. She told me that they were filming them with the white helmets moving around, and she said they were filming them as if they were saving them. But they didn't actually allow them to get to their children. They put them back on the buses. They then locked the buses, forced them to sit in those buses and watch their children being taken away, wounded, mutilated, dying, dead, injured children, being piled into the backs of 4 Turkish ambulances. And the bodies were driven away with the mothers locked inside the buses, pressed up against the window, distraught, trying to get to their children that were literally being driven away from them, and they didn't know where they were going.
It was an emotional day for McCollin's mother, Cheryl, who was in court as video was played from the beginning of Andre's ordeal.
I never signed up for him to be tortured, terrorized, and abused. I had no idea, no idea that they tortured the children in the school.
I'm Mark Ackerman.
Hi, everybody. I'm Maria Stefanos. Fox Undercover's camera, the only one in court today, as a jury is given its first look at that disturbing video. We want to warn you that the video is tough to watch. It's the only
Dramatic video of New York teenager Andre McCollins restrained face down, a helmet on his head, screaming for help.
No. I was shot when we were 16 or 17. I was 31 that day.
As McCollins' attorney just described, the teenager was shocked 31 times in all that day in 2002. McCollins is suing the Canton-based center, calling it torture.
Now, an adorable video has captured a baby's first few moments of life. The newborn just couldn't let go of her mother as nurses tried to take him away for cleaning. Show me. The newborn infant who was delivered into the world through cesarean section just refused to let go of his mother's face after he was presented for skin.
In the international terminal at Bush Airport, big hugs and welcome signs are nothing new. But for this family,
are you ready to finally meet Lucy?
The wait for their soon-to-be daughter to arrive from China is full of overwhelming emotion.
Oh my God.
Like every mom would, Audrey Shook spotted six-year-old Lucy right away.
There's Lucy.
And from the moment they first met,
hey, Mama.
There was an instant connection and an end to a journey that started long ago.
These are the kids that are unwanted. They're the kids that nobody else wants. They've been sitting on lists for their entire life or sitting in an orphanage.
We don't see it as we're going to help her. We feel like she's going to bless our life.
Like a rainbow.
I joyfully pronounce you husband and wife. What God has joined together, let no one separate.
True colors are beautiful. I see your true color shining.
I kind of have to wait with the finish, really, or I'll crack up to it. This world makes you crazy. Unfortunately, her father passed within 7 days of that. Okay, man up. I think what I'm trying to... as I was watching my kids, that went through my head. And really... what makes us human is our relationships. It's how we relate to each other. That gives us strength. The most sacred relationship is the parent to the child, your parent to you, you to your kids. And then you have extended family, then friends, then community, church, whatever it is. From my perspective, all of those things, which are the glue that keeps humanity together, are being absolutely devastated. And from one perspective, I've shown you some of that tonight. Literally blown apart. I mean, that was just awful watching that. But I had to edit that because it was worse than that. When you're down and out, when you have no money, who comes for you? It's your brothers, your sisters, your mates. They help you. If we don't have that relationship, we have no strength. We have no power. We have nothing. If we have no work... the way I see society going, one possibility is as these relationships are more and more destroyed, and they really are if you really look, what will happen is we will just have this, there won't be, we'll just be units. Do you understand what I'm saying? This is where it looks to me like it's going, where you can be, and if you have a problem, you have people that will come and back you up and help you. If you have nothing, if you're born out of a nectogenesis pod, you have nothing. And I think, in closing, if you're waiting for something to happen so that you do something and stand up for humanity, let me tell you something. It's already happened. I've just given you two references there to 10 to 15 years. Yeah, that's it. The clock is ticking. And time now. If you're going to stand up and do something, you have to do it. And in order for my children to have a future and for your children to have the future, we have to do something. Thank you for listening to me. Thank you.